Pot has huge eyes, enormous grabbing claws, and a lean, streamlined body fit for darting through the seas after prey. Is it a predatory fish? Is it an agile squid? Or is it a voracious mantis shrimp? None of these actually, it's a thalacocephalan. Thalacocephala is a mysterious group of extinct arthropods that show an alternative body plan for a swimming, predatory creature compared to the ubiquitous fish and squid types. As such, it provides a hint of the breadth of possibilities that may exist on alien planets. But what are thalacocephalans, and what precisely can we learn from these extinct aliens? Let's find out! New discoveries are often made at the same time by different people. This especially goes for the elusive thalacocephalans starting in the early 80s. Three research teams in Milan, London and Paris, respectively, had each independently studied different fossil animals that were so unique that they had to classify them into novel groups. It was in Milan that Paolo Arduini and Giovanni Pinna described the group's first known species, dubbed Ostenocaris cipriformis, a 20 centimeter long shelled creature from the Jurassic of Italy. Initially, it was regarded as a primitive kind of barnacle, and they decided to refer to an entirely new class of animals of their own they called thalacocephala, literally meaning pouch heads. Arduini and Pinna believe they found a missing link between more generalized crustaceans and the highly specialized and sessile filter-feeding barnacles. The big structure bulging out at the front was thought of as a scaly pouch for anchoring the creature into the sediment with the three pairs of robust legs lifting the rear up into the open water. Its smaller feather-like hind limbs were then supposedly used for creating a water current to be filtered in a similar way to modern-day barnacles. Only a few years later, and unaware of the Italian findings, paleontologists Sylvie Secretan and Bernard Rioux in Paris described another large species from the Jurassic as Dolocaris ingens. Because of its unusual mix of characters, they established a new class called Conchyliocarida. The French scientists recognized the rounded structure at the front as a pair of huge compound eyes, and the creature was correctly interpreted as an actively swimming predator. In that same year, Derek Briggs and William Rolfe, working from London, published their own study of a number of enigmatic fossil forms from Devonian deposits in Australia, for which they created the crustacean order of Concavicarida. Shortly after publication of the different findings, it was realized that the different species had so many characters in common, they clearly represented the same class of what were assumed to be some kind of highly unusual crustaceans. Even though the interpretation as an actively swimming predator took hold, the class name of Thalacocephala nevertheless won out, recognizing the Italians as the first to describe them. The names Concavicarida and Conchyliocarida were rendered orders within this new class. The following decade, a plethora of new additions came forward from many different parts of the world, with many hitherto unclassified fossils finally finding their home as thalacocephalans. Added to the earliest forms being the Concavicarids from the Devonian of Australia, there were Ankytocazocaris and Ostenocaris from the early Triassic of Madagascar, Atropicaris and Microcaris from the late Triassic of Italy, Ostenocaris and Rugocaris from the early Jurassic of Italy, Kilianocaris and Paraostenia from the middle Jurassic of France, Myrocaris and Clausocaris from the late Jurassic of Germany, Protozoia and Pseudorhynchus from the Cretaceous of Lebanon. Especially the latter are close to my heart because they are the species I personally described from my master's thesis, which was later published here. A more remarkable and controversial example is a Nyctozoan from the Silurian of Scotland, pushing the group's origin ever further back into time. It was originally reconstructed as an unusual and grotesque kind of chordate by Scourfield and later Alexander Ritchie. Wim van den Bruggen and Frederick Schramm eventually deduced that the reconstruction had the wrong orientation and that it actually represented a giant thalicocephalon. I was in the very room when van den Brugge first presented the fossils to Professor Frederick Schramm, who was my mentor during that period. A nyctozoan is important in being the largest known thalicocephalon and one of the earliest known, preserving many interesting anatomical details because of its size. Having seen its fossil remains with my very own eyes, I'm not really fond of many of the reconstructions that you can find out there. These artists' impressions lean too heavily on the original interpretation as a chordate with a bloated carapace, making a very strange angle to the rest of the body, making it stick up dorsally. Schramm and van den Brugge themselves actually considered a nyctozoan to have been flattened on its side, much like a halibut, and thus probably lying in ambush on the sea bottom. It's also possible that this weird look is based on a preservation artifact, with the animal being crushed and its carapace split open and flattened, which is why its eyes are so far apart. This way, the creature would have had a much more compact body tucked well underneath the carapace, like most other thalicocephalans, and its two discrete compound eyes gathered together. Paleoblogger Science Det, who has also looked at the fossils, came to the same conclusions, by the way. So this is my own reconstruction of a sleeker and more nimble anyctozoan. Unfortunately, further investigation of these intriguing fossils has been halted because the only site where these can be found was closed after the Scottish Natural Heritage Organization allegedly neglected to intervene with fossil theft that had been ongoing for a series of years. Ever since its discovery, the class of Thalicocephala has been expanded with a great many more fossil species, all the way back to the Ordovician, showing the group's deep roots. In many cases, these were at first erroneously described as members of other groups, which indicates that many hitherto unidentified fossil arthropods may also be thalicocephalans. The most conspicuous feature of all thalicocephala is their shield-like carapace, and this is often the only body part that is preserved. It's relatively elongate, and its two sides fold downwards, covering almost the entire body, with only the limbs and eyes protruding. There are no clear signs of antennae. The carapace is usually very thin and barely mineralized, often only being reinforced with thickened margins and ridges. It was clearly pretty lightweight, yet sturdy at the same time. The carapace shows an enormous variation in shape across the entire group. Sometimes long spines stick out from the front and rear ends of the shield, which is typical of pelagic crustaceans. In many thalicocephalans, the carapace is ornamented with a string of small circular structures. Spread in specific patterns, these were by some interpreted as bioluminescent photophores. It has also been proposed that these structures were some kind of sensory organs, analogous to the lateral line system in fish, or perhaps homologous with the lattice organs of thecostracans. In some species, the carapace also has longitudinal ridges, perhaps for hydrodynamic purposes. And often it's also covered with microscopic furrows, perhaps meant to reduce turbulence. Very distinctive are the large raptorial limbs that protrude from underneath the carapace. There are three pairs, of which the posterior one often is the largest. They bend forward and are clearly designed to grasp and hold prey items. Further back behind, there is a row of between 8 and maybe up to 16 pairs of smaller limbs that end in feathery pedal-like structures, apparently used for swimming. The swimming limbs are really extensions of oblique elongated limb bases hidden beneath the posterior part of the carapace. Phosphatized remains of extensive musculature that used to fill these limb bases indicates most thalicocephalans were powerful and fast swimmers. The most noteworthy thing about thalicocephalans is that many forms possessed unusually large eyes sticking out from the front of the carapace, often placed in a concave notch. Ironically, it was these large eyes that were erroneously described as an anchoring pouch that gave the thalacocephalans their name. Closer studies of more well-preserved specimens revealed the scales were actually tiny ommatilia. The expanded eyes of many species are reminiscent of those of Hyperid amphipods that live in deep-sea pelagic habitats, where there's very little light. Most thalacocephalans, on the other hand, probably lived in shallow benthic habitats and were thus relying on acute eyesight for hunting prey comparable to dragonflies and mantis shrimp. 8 pairs of lamellar gills, very similar to those of decapod crustaceans, were covered by the carapace, and there also was a large, muscular foregut right behind the eyes. All of this paints a picture of a very unusual arthropod, highly adapted to an active, swimming lifestyle, built for speed and agility, with acute senses and a voracious appetite. This has very interesting implications for the generalized evolution of aquatic animals, especially when thinking about alien biospheres. But that's the subject of another video. Make sure you don't miss that one, so don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell icon. Also, please consider supporting me on Patreon. For now, thanks for watching, cheers and bye-bye!